Hello, and welcome to tutorial number 45 of our long series of 2020, where we're going to look into a tool for Grasshopper that's called Mesh Mirror Cut, and we'll just take a look at how we can use it to make some funky stuff, as per usual in this channel. So I will begin by actually, well, first things first. Mesh Mirror Cut belongs to a plugin for Grasshopper that's called Pufferfish. And it's a super useful plugin. If you don't have it, or add-on, is it a plugin or add-on? I don't know. But it's super useful. If you don't have it, you should have it. You can get it from Food for Rhino, as for every plugin, and it has, you know, all of the steps on how to download it, how to load it into Grasshopper, and so on. So once you have it downloaded and installed into Grasshopper, you'll see all of these sub-tabs here that belong to the plugin. And the one that we are interested in is actually not even a sub-tab, it's just a single node. And that node is called Mirror Cut Mesh. For some reason, I will keep saying Mesh Mirror Cut, but it's, yeah, Mirror Cut Mesh. This guy right here. It's a big node, that is why we have a separate tutorial about it. And also it's a node that can be used within a loop, right? So you can apply this mesh mirror cut to the same shape multiple times if you put it in a loop, which means that we are going to also use Anemone plugin. Let me scribble that for you. Well, maybe not like that. Like that, scribble. So we're using Anemone, and we're also using Pufferfish. There we go, these two. So from Pufferfish we have the mesh mirror cut, and from Anemone we have loop start and loop end. Those of you who are familiar with the channel know that, you know, I really like using loops in my definitions. Okay, so let's begin by connecting loop start with loop end, like so. That's what we always do. And then let's start thinking of how can this mesh mirror cut be used between loop start and loop end, you know, to create this kind of a loop of cutting, mirroring the same mesh. So perhaps the best approach would be to first have something to cut, right, and to mirror. So let us do something super simple. I'll probably make a hexagon. So I'm just taking the polygon tool here in Rhino. I'm choosing number of sides to be 6. I'll start drawing it from 0. And I'll draw, let's say, 10 units. Hexagon that has a radius of 10. Something like that. And then maybe I will take the same hexagon. I'll take that hexagon, and I'll copy and scale it down to something like this. I don't really care about, you know, the size of it. So we end up having something like this, and I will take the inner one. Maybe it can be a little bit I know that it's not important, but I just want to get a nice proportion. And then I'll take the smaller one, the inner one, and I'll move it up. Something like that. Then I will just select both of them and loft between them to get this kind of shape, you know, simple. I don't need the curves anymore, so I just delete them. So we end up with this kind of a hexagon shape. Okay, sure. Let's reference it in. So first of all, this is not a mesh, this is a B-rep, right? And mesh mirror cut, as you might expect, asks you for a mesh. But let's convert this BREP into a mesh here in Grasshopper. So I will reference it in as a BREP, boundary representation. Right click on the node, set one BREP, click on the shape. And actually I'll hide the shape in Rhino. Wait, we need some music for this. There we go. This is gonna take up some time. So we have our shape in Rhino. Reference in Grasshopper now, and I want to create a mesh from it. So there's two ways of how to do it. First one, or rather three ways. First way is just grabbing a mesh component, plugging it in like so, and that's it. So now we have a... It just converts the BREP into a mesh. It's not the cleanest, but it always works, right? Then we have an alternative, which is using BREP mesh or mesh BREP component. Connecting BREP to the BREP input, and for settings using either speed, quality, or custom. So this gives us more control. With speed, we have... Okay, in this case, speed and quality doesn't really matter because everything is flat. But if you have a curvilinear shape, then it starts mattering. My webcam is way too bright. And that's a little bit dark. Okay, that should be fine. The sun is out, you see. So that's another way, and it's a little bit... it also works all the time, but it's not the cleanest one for this particular instance. For this particular instance, the cleanest one is called simple mesh. Simple mesh. I really hope that simple mesh belongs to basic Rhino. Like to basic Grasshopper. I don't think it belongs to any of the plugins. So it's under mesh utilities, simple mesh. If it's not on your if you can't see it in your Grasshopper, then you might need to download a third plugin, which is called Mesh Edit. That. But I think you should see it. Either way, the way this works is it takes every rectangular surface of your BREP and it converts it into a single polygon, meaning that all of this will just become a super clean mesh, right? With 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 polygons. So super simple, super clean. If you give it a surface that has more than 4 corner points, this will start complaining and making mistakes. So it only works as long as you're working with surfaces that have 4 corners. I think 3 corners also work for this, but 4 is the best. Okay. So we have our mesh. Let's ignore the loop for a bit and let's just see how mesh mirror cut works. All right, we have our mesh and I'll connect it to the M input of mesh mirror cut because that's the... Actually, let me do this, display full names. There we go. So mesh, of course, goes into mesh. Mirror plane is the plane that is cutting, right? So how do we do it? Well, let's create a rectangle, and I'll just do like 10 by 10, this kind of a rectangle here, and let's reference it in CRB, and I'll build a plane from this rectangle, right? So how do we, this is just a flat curve, right? So how do we get its plane? Well, we ask, is the curve planner, is planner. Well, it's not, let's say we're asking if the curve is planar. We're actually not doing that, but let's just imagine that we are. So isPlanar is the tool that we want to use. Asks for a surface, don't worry about it, just give it a curve, and it will immediately give you the plane output right here, which means we can use that plane output as our mirror plane right here. Bam, gets mirrored, right? And I can hide the original one so that we see the mirrored version. Okay, so this is nothing too fancy, you know, it just gets mirrored. But if I move it, if I move it like so, it gets further away. So this just works as any, you know, any mirror plane would, except in these cases where it's doing something a little bit more funky, right? Because it's also cutting. If you're mirroring the form through its some axis that intersects with it, it's not just going to mirror, it's also going to cut the form. And let me turn off ortho snap and object snap and just have fun with this. So if I move it around, you can see, you know, the different variations of how it's cutting the form. Quite simple, but a really good start to build up some complex behavior. And you can see the way it's connecting is a little bit weird. So not weird, but the behavior is a bit weird in this case. So let's see how we can either mitigate that, or what kind of options do we have for how it's cutting and how it's connecting. So here we have reach, offset, flip, join, and then so on. Actually, let's start from the beginning, from reach. Right? What does this do? Well, if I have, let's say, 0.1. Is 0.1 too much? No, let's not do 0.1. Let's do like 1 for reach. It actually doesn't really show us that well. It will try to snap vertices together. And this is like the gap between the vertices at which they are going to snap together during a cut. That's reach. Offset is kind of similar. It's opposite of it, right? So this is without offset, this is with offset, right? So it pushes away the vertices from each other. I wonder why offset and reach have the same, why they work together like so. Well, it's not about that. For now, I'll have them disconnected and we'll come back to them, and I'll talk more about it in just a second. It's pretty hard to show reach and offset with just two polygons here. We have flip, which is just a toggle. If I turn on the toggle or the flip, the mirror plane gets flipped over, right? So it cuts in another direction. So I'll turn it off like that. Oh, maybe this will show you how reach works. Nah, it's not great. Okay. So flip, I usually never have it turned on. If I need to flip the mirror plane, I will just type in flip. Like select the curve and type in flip, and it's going to do exactly the same thing, right? Then we have join. Basically, would you like to join the mirror cut mesh? Yeah, always joined. Keep the mesh and mirror it normally if the mirror cut, bleh. If it is mirror cut into non-existence, false. I believe if we have this toggled, so it's a toggle, if we have this toggle that's false and we take our mirror plane and we move it to the other side, basically the mirror plane kind of mirrors and cuts the mesh out of existence. But if this is set to false or to true, it's going to flip the mirror plane, which is quite an interesting behavior. Some funky stuff. Usually I just don't have it. I have it turned off. And if the mirror plane is messing up, then I fix it in Rhino. Okay, connection type. This is an interesting one. So you have six types in total, stemming between 0 and 5. Split faces, remove faces, shrink faces, and then split, remove, and shrink, but without connections, right? So out of all of these, first three are important to us or interesting to us. Other three, option number 3, 4, and 5, are not, because we want it to be a continuous surface, so connection should be established between the original and the mirrored version. So let's go for a slider between 0 and 2, 0, 1, or 2, and connect it to connection type. So 0 does this. Let me just show you the original, right? And as the mirror plane, mirror cut moves here, some additional vertices were created, and it kind of connects it quite nicely. So that's connection type 0, which is split faces. Connection type 1 is remove faces. So it's going to cut away these two faces and it's going to reconnect only these four sides, meaning that as I connect them, this becomes a huge hole, right? So that's connection type 1. And connection type 2 is, how is it called, shrink faces? I don't actually know how it works. I should probably investigate it before I start a tutorial, but honestly I always use just connection type 0. That's just how I do it. So connection type 0 for us should be the way to go. Alright, so we have that. In terms of bulge, oh, by the way, I can show you like connection type 5, for instance. Right? Connection type 5, no connection. Connection type 6, doesn't work. Connection type 4, no connection. And connection type 3, connection type 3 should also not produce a connection. But it does. Well, that's weird. Either way, connection type 0 works for us. Then we have bulge, which is said to be minus 0.5. Let me do -1.1, the slider, and just show you how the bulge works. Or I guess not. Stopped working, huh? Yeah, sure. Does it only work with connection type 2? Yeah. Okay, so it only works with connection type 2. The bulge, I mean. And let me give it more resolution and just show it to you right now. So this is -1. And let's kind of move it towards 0. So this is at 0. And let's move it further. This is +1, right? So it can either bulge in or bulge out wherever a mirror cut is being made, right? Somewhat useful. I don't know. Usually, since I'm using connection type 0, the bulge doesn't really matter. But if you need that aesthetic, then you can use the bulge to get it. For now, I'll have it as default -0.5. Then we have divisions. What would happen if we have divisions set to 2? Absolutely nothing. Okay. And then, well, so I just skip it. And then we have weld vertices, which is said to be basically every vertice that is, every two vertices that are closer than 0.01 to each other are going to be welded together, and it's perfect. It just works, so we don't need to mess around with it. And basically, yeah, that's how we get the output, which is a mesh mirror cut mesh, right? And then the nice thing is that I can, for instance, take this, copy paste, take that mesh mirror cut mesh, connect it, and just define, oh yeah, and I need to copy and paste this as well. And I just can define a new cut plane with a new rectangle, right? So I'll just take this rectangle, also copy it, set one curve. So this is my new cut plane right here, right? And then I can define one more cut and maybe be a little bit more fancy about it. You know, do some weird stuff. Cool, huh? So you can get pretty far with this by just adding mesh mirror cut. But this is every time when I need to do this, I immediately see that, oh yeah, I need a loop, right? I can't just keep copying this. So instead of doing this, I am going to take this and put it in an anemone loop, right? So let's start by defining how many planes are we going to have? And for this tutorial, I'll do 7. Let's do 7, why not? So I will just take that rectangle tool, 10 by 10, that seems okay. I'll just take this rectangle and just move it somewhere here. I'll just copy it once, twice. Oh, that's going to make 8 of them, but that's maybe fine. And now let's do 7, so like that. And then I will just reference them all in, right? CRB, right click, set multiple, and I'll be mindful of how I click on them, right? So first one, second one, third one, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. Enter, right? Now I have no idea which one is which, right? So I actually want to be able to tell. So I will do text tag, and I will say I need a center point in each of these rectangles. So I will say area will give me a centroid like that. So that's the location, that's going to be the location. And the text is going to be just series of numbers, or maybe I can just do, skip that. Let's just do it other way around. Item index, and just connect the curves to list and also the item to get an index of each curve, and connect that to the text. Then for the color, I will just swatch. I'll just use white color or black. Yeah, let's use black. And I will right click on the text tag and I'll choose large as my text size, large. Okay, that's that. So now I have numbering for my curves. Let me group that and just move it somewhere here and call it numbering of planes. Okay, so now on to actually using them to cut my mesh. So let's disconnect real fast and let's think about how the loop is going to work. So I will have a mesh, right? My starting mesh coming into the loop, and then it's going to be cut, right, with the mesh mirror cut tool, and then that cut mesh is going to be fed in back into the data stream here. And then that cut mesh is going to be cut again and cut again and cut again, and by the end of it is going to be parsed here as an output, as a single mesh. So what happens if this accidentally produces two meshes as it's doing right now? Well, we just want to mesh join to join them up, right? It's basically if you cut a more complex piece and come on, there we go. If you cut a more complex piece, it sometimes will have a disconnected part. We want to join that part back into the big mesh. So mesh join is an important one. All right, so that's easy. And now these curves will need to be used to define a plane here. So let's see how we can do that. Well, first of all, we have seven curves, right? So the question is, how many times are we repeating the loop? Well, we're repeating it seven times, right? So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So let me create a slider here for times of repetitions for the loop. Between 0, ... 6. So repetition 0 is going to give us use the first plane, this plane right here for cutting. Repetition 1 is going to use this plane, repetition 2 is going to use this plane. So we have our curves for the planes, and we need to choose the correct one for that particular cycle within the loop. So let me do list item. So I'm choosing from the list of curves that I have here, and my index is going to be actually the counter, because this is counting at which loop are we at, loop at which step of the loop are we at. So right now we're at step 0. So counter goes into here, and that will give us a polyline from here, which is polyline 0. Great. Let me connect that to here, like so, and it gets a plane. Let's just check real fast. Polyline 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Super. Then for trigger, I will just use a button as usual, you know, to reset the simulation. And this should be good enough. This should be working. So let me hide everything except the final output of the mesh, and let me have a custom preview. Let me slap on a custom preview for it with some swatch, color swatch. What's a nice color? Blue. Sure. Ooh, ew. Why is it doing like that? We'll fix it in just a second, but for some reason it's not that, it doesn't look that good. So let's see, if I were to say, do we unweld or do we smooth it? Maybe we should smooth it. So let's do Catmull-Clark on it. Catmull-Clark subdivision on it, and feed that into the mesh, so we end up with something like this. That looks a little bit nicer, and maybe this can be, sorry, now I'm just designing at this point. What if I don't want it to be that smooth, right? Because if I increase the level to 3 of this bad boy, and actually let's grab that first mesh mirror cut plane here and kind of mess around with it. flip. So it does work, but what if we don't really want it to be that smooth? Well, maybe if we were to say, what if we did Catmull Clark subdivision at level 1 and smooth naked edges would be, we would choose fixed like that, right? And then we did another pass at it with level 2. But this time around, it's not fixed, it's smooth. Then it should be, yeah, now it's less smooth. It retains a little bit of its original form. And also the, seems like the shading kind of fixed itself, so I'm happy with that. Okay, let's make it nice now. So I will use my first mirror cut to do something like this. And then maybe let's use the, let's jump one step further, like that. Why? Oh yeah, yeah, okay. So it's already using this guy right here. And then I will rotate it. I will flip it. Now we get something like this, and maybe I want to do something like that. Display preview mesh edges. Why doesn't it show me the mesh edges? That's super strange. Wireframe? There we go. Okay, so it does that. I think this is something we can work with. Maybe like this more. Okay. Then let's jump to the second plane, or it's actually the third plane. I need to see which plane I'm working with. So the curve gets chosen, and let's do some sort of a, let me move this away. So the curve gets chosen here, and let's do area. So we get the center point of the curve. Or, oh yeah, I know. We can just do preview, custom preview. Swatch. No, we can't. Okay, we can't. Apparently we can't. So can I just do boundary surface, swatch, custom preview? Yeah, I can. Okay. And let's just give it a little bit of alpha. So now we will see which one is the active one. Whoops. Like that. Take that plane, move it to the correct position, and now let's see what's going on. So first of all, I'll flip it over, and I'll move it down. No, I'll move it up, not down, like that. So we end up getting this, and okay, what happens if I rotate it like so? So I want those two to connect. And this one to be twisting like that, more, that, perfect, like that. Can it open? Okay, so if it opens like that, then we can actually just rotate it, oops, that's too much, like that, and move it back in, like so. So we end up getting something like this. Okay, next one. Three. Move it to the position. Maybe three only does this. Yeah, I think that's fine. So we end up with something like that, and then we have 4. And 4 could actually do something like this. That opening is a little bit too big. And that gap, I want that gap to be there. Okay, so this is 4. I'm trying to go through it as fast as possible. I would probably just spend much more time working on this, but we don't have it. We don't have the time. Okay, let's make it a little bit longer. So I will rotate number 5 like so. Connect it like so, like that. Mm-hmm. Close that gap. Okay, we end up with something like this. Then number 6. Oh, that's the last one. Okay. So number 6 is going to be pretty straightforward. 90 degrees flipped. Something like that. A bit closer, something like that. Okay, so we end up having this kind of form, right? And we can do many different things with it, you know, to make it nicer. I can use mesh thicken from ViewerBird, transform mesh thicken. So I can take that mesh and I can offset it by 0.5. That is not the offset time. That's, yeah, like that. Oh, 0.5 is actually super large. 0.1 then. Yeah, there we go. And then do it again. Oops. By this time with negative 0.1, so that I'm offsetting it to the other side. Give it one color to one layer and another color to the other layer. Right? So that the inside has its own the inside has its own color. There are some issues here and there, but all in all, I think this is fine. So what would happen if we change the connection type to 1? Oh yeah, and we need to reset the... Okay, so with connection type set to 1, it breaks. With connection type set to 2, maybe it won't break. Let's see. No, it still breaks. So for different connection types, you need to have different for different connection types, you need to have like different approaches of how you're moving those mirror planes. Okay, so we have that done, and now let's see. Let's come back to our original form, original shape, and try to make something a little bit more funky with it. So let me hide everything, then show selected, just turn on show selected, and I'll just select my shape. Come on, shaded view. All right, and in shaded view, for some reason, it still shows me the form, so I'll just right click on the custom previews and turn off the render option for them. There we go. So let's do something super simple. I'll just take this form and I'll copy it down like so. I will type in solid PT on and I'll select the bottom points. I'll just scale them up by 1.5, something like this, right? And then I want to loft between these two forms, Is 1.5 too much? Maybe it's too much. We'll see. I want a loft between these two forms, so I'll just type in loft between this and this, this and this, and I'll just do it 6 times. You could also just dupe border and loft the two polylines, but it's just 6 curves. I mean, how lazy can you be? There we go. I'll select it, join. Still everything has rectangular surfaces, and I'll reference it in as my BREP, set1 BREP, or actually let me turn this back to 0, set1 BREP, like that, hide it, and let's see what's going to happen. So, and actually this is going to get in the way a bit. So let me for now turn off all of this smoothing and so on. Not turn off, but disconnect this whole smoothing. I'll just have a very calm custom preview. Like that. With a little bit different color. Display, preview mesh edges. Well, maybe we can have the first set of subdivisions just to get it going. I wonder why is it... Oh, yeah, it needs to smooth it out there. Is it possible to not have it smoothed? Yeah, if we unweld it, right? So let me do unweld mesh right here, like that, and connect it like so. So what unweld mesh does, it basically takes vertices that have an angle lower, higher than what you define here, and it's going to disconnect those vertices into two pairs. So let me do angle 0, and actually you can see how the shading changes when I do this. So this is after unwelding, and this is before unwelding, right? So before unwelding, all of the vertices were singular, not duplicated. And if they are singular, that means everything is going to be shaded smooth. If they are duplicated, everything is going to be shaded flat. So I made them duplicated. Okay, and then if we smooth it, it still doesn't like it. What if we do loop subdivision? It's a little bit better, but then it triangulates it. Ah, screw it. Let's keep it like that. This is just a small thing. All right, so we have that going on, and let's actually take a look. Let's take a look at how it's going to look. Mesh edges. I also want to see the mesh edges just on top of my shape. So this is after first mesh mirror cut. It looks like that. That's kind of cool. After the second one, looks like that. It's also good. After third one, that's actually nice. Fourth one, can we? The fourth one is a little bit, it takes away the from the aesthetic, I think. Because the first one is nice, and the second one, the third one is nice, and the fourth one then starts messing it up. So I will fix the third one and the fourth one. And let me bring back the smoothing here, like that. Render, hello? Render, there we go. And render here, and actually turn off that. And turn off that, just so that we can see better. And this shouldn't be white because white is way too intense. Yeah, okay. So it messes up during step three, right? Yeah, during here. Or does it? Actually, it kind of looks cool. Yeah, I take it back. Looks like a fish. Looks cool. I'll keep it. Step four. Okay, so now step four is weird, and also, does it make a mistake? Where's the inside? Does it completely close everything off? Okay, we need to investigate step four. So let me show everything, and let me hide the original shape. Let me turn on the text tags and turn on the render for the plane. So this is the culprit, right? Element four is the culprit. Doesn't seem like it's like anything is reacting to it though. Oh no, never mind. It is stuff is reacting to it. And here we can see some openings being created, but it's way too little. So let's see what we can do with it. Like that. That's great. So it opens up like that. Actually, I'll jump back to the third iteration, because the third one closes everything up pretty heavily. So let's see if we can kind of make it not as closed. So now the back is also open, not just the front. I think that makes up a bit a nicer composition. Can we open it more? Yeah, that's great. Okay, let's have it like that. And then fourth one. So fourth one right now duplicates the third one. So we need to flip this bad boy open like that. That's great. Yeah, I like how it's turning out. And then the fifth one is on that side, and I actually really enjoy how fifth one looks like. Oh, that was the second one. That's my mistake. It's hard to fish out the fifth one from here. There it is. So fifth one does that. Maybe we can deal with that. But I do want them to reconnect a little bit. So let me just rotate the fifth one just a tiny bit. Just a tiny bit more. There we go. So now the fifth one reconnects. And then we will have the last one, the sixth one. Wait for it, it's calculating. Okay, so the sixth one, I can't even see where there it is. That's the sixth one, and it's just right in the middle. So I don't want it to be right in the middle. I actually want something like this. Yeah. Something like this. Maybe. Maybe we can. So this is taking way too long to calculate. So let me turn down the subdivision levels to level 1 instead of level 2. Just to have a faster response time from the script. Let's just see. Ooh, this is cool. Aha, okay, so it does that. Okay. So that means if I rotate it like so, it's going to spread apart. And then if I rotate it back here, it's going to reconnect like so. Maybe. Let's do this instead. And then rotate it like that. Oh, so we're actually back where we started. Oh man. Can I? Can I force it to be like that? That's actually also kind of cool. Yeah, let's call it a day. So this is what we end up with. And let me bake this out so that you can see it in a nicer view. I think I just made a big mistake because I divided it up to level 4 or level 3, sorry. It made it, but I think my meshes are now super heavy. Yes, they're more than a million polygons. So let's do level 2. As you can see, it's super easy to reach really high complexity levels with this approach. So that's level 2, and I will just bake this guy out, and I will bake this guy out. I will stop rendering, or actually let me save this file. As always, by the way, the file is both Rhino and Grasshopper files are going to be available for Patreon supporters. Everyone else, you can just follow along. And you'll be able to create this form by yourself. So let me save it for the Patreon supporters. Desktop tutorial, or how do I name them? Tutorial 2020-45. Save file. Save as tutorial 2020-45. Okay, so we have that done. And now let's just take a look at a pretty version of it. So I will disable render here, disable render there, and disable render there, so that I can now close this, close that. Okay, cell CRV, hide those. Go to Arctic view and just take one of the meshes, and I'll do it in Arctic view. So I'll take one of the meshes and we'll give it a material. Just a new material that's going to be plastic color, red. Actually, this one, I want this one to be red, and this one I want to be new material. Plaster color gray. Ground. Is it possible to not have a material for the ground plane? Probably not, huh? But what if I use the same plastic material for the ground? Yeah, that looks quite decent. So let me just create a new material that is going to be... Which one are we using? Let's use plastic, and I'll just use black like that. Reflectivity lower, even lower, lower. Clarity frosted, frosted. Mm-hmm. Can it be even lower? Well, not that low. I don't like it. Ground. Ground plane. Let's turn it off. That was a bad idea. Bad idea. Instead, I will just say that my solid color should be a bit darker. Something like that. That should do the trick. Okay. We are done. We have it. We have it finished. We have it done. So I hope. Oh, turn table. Slower. There we go. So I hope you enjoyed this one. This is one of the faster ways of how you can create complexity real quick. And yeah, I'll see you in the next one.